Do all doctors use the same terms when describing spine disc findings on MRIs? Many of you have had MRI studies of your spine and had discussion with your doctors about the findings. Oftentimes, it seems that doctors are using the terms disc bulge or disc herniation interchangeably. It can get confusing both for the patient and, unfortunately, also the medical doctors who need to discuss the findings. So, in order to come up to some agreement on these terms, doctors representing spinal specialists and radiologists formed a group to define these terms. The last recognized effort resulted in the publication of an article called The Lumbar Disc Nomenclature, Version Number 2, published in the Spine Journal in 2014. Very few people know that this often referenced article about standards of reading spine MRIs was led by an orthopedic spinal specialist, Dr. David Fardon. As a spinal specialist, a doctor who actually examines and determines treatments based on these tests, not just interpret the findings, Dr. Fardon championed the effort and the publication. This 2014 paper established a common naming protocol about disc findings. The authors took great pains to state that MRI findings by themselves cannot offer any information on whether the findings are caused by trauma or natural occurrence. To directly quote the paper, quote, "The definitions of diagnoses are not intended to imply external etiologic events such as trauma. They do not imply relationship to symptoms, and they do not define or imply the need for specific treatment," unquote. To summarize the paper, disc findings can be broken down into two main types. The first is a disc bulge, which is a uniform presence of disc material outside the walls of the spine bone. The paper actually uses the term ring apophysis, but for the public, it's the margin of the spine bones. If you'd seen our prior videos about disc bulges versus herniations, it is the bulging of the tire wall concept. In certain deformities, such as scoliosis, there can be some asymmetry of the bulge, but it's still a bulge. The second is the herniated disc, where a focal or local displacement of disc material occurs. My prior video explained this as the jelly donut model. Focal or localized is defined by displacement that is less than 25% of the circumference of the whole disc. I've had many spirited debates on whether I should call a herniation or a protrusion or a bulge or vice versa. Here's the direct quote on page 2533 from this often referenced study. Quote, "By exclusion of other terms and by reasons of simplicity and common usage, herniated disc is the best term to denote displacement of disc material. Disc herniations then can be broken down into three different types. Number one is a contained protrusion, which are herniations that are still connected by an intact outer fiber of the annulus. Number two is an extrusion, which means that disc herniation is no longer contained by the last fibers of the annulus. And number three, sequestrations, which means that disc herniation is no longer in contact with the rest of the disc and it's its own island of disc material. In addition to the discussion about disc herniation and bulges, this paper establishes that the breaks in the outside part of the disc called the annulus should be called fissures instead of tears. The term tear suggests a traumatic event, and it is well known that these annular disruptions can be a natural process not associated with any specific trauma. Since 1993, it's been established that having these disc annular fissures, herniations, and degeneration is an expected part of life, and oftentimes these findings are not causing any pain to the person with these findings. The paper also mentions various research studies that show almost every disc that degenerates or ages will also have an annular fissure. It's a normal part of life, like having wrinkles and thinning hair. The final point of the paper is to discuss the so-called high-intensity zone. In the early 1990s, these findings of an area of brightness of the annulus was thought to be a sign of an acute problem, an indication of the cause of pain. In the early 1990s, many spinal fusions were performed because of these findings on the MRI, but with unpredictable clinical results. It turns out these high-intensity zones represented fluid or granulation tissue in the annulus. The presence of the high-intensity zone is not specific to a traumatic event and is not always associated with any pain complaints. It may not even correspond to a true annular fissure. Even today, its significance is not established and remains hotly debated. To me, many parts of the disc nomenclature study are consistent with what I already use in my practice. I define the problem either a bulge or a herniation. If asked to further clarify a herniation, then it's either contained, extruded, or sequestered. To me, the MRI by itself cannot be used to age when the disc finding was created. To me, the presence or absence of a high-intensity zone has very little benefit in determining the treatment option for the patients. I learned from the 1990s experience. I've had the honor of listening to Dr. Fardon speak in past meetings. While he retired from practice a few years ago, he has left an impact on physician education and will always be honored as one of the greatest teachers and proponents of rational, compassionate, and competent orthopedic and spine care. I hope you found this discussion interesting. Thanks for watching. If you'd like more information about similar topics, please subscribe to our newsletter or YouTube channel.